This is NDTV. And you're watching NDTV Hindu.
Hello and welcome to Corridors of Power. I'm Sanjay Pinto. Now, we usually interview political leaders and bureaucrats on this show. But then, power does not always have to flow from that red beacon atop your car, which incidentally even MPs will soon have. Power can also flow from a desire to do honorary work. Guest today is Chinni Krishna, the Chairman Emeritus of Blue Cross of India and also the Vice Chairperson of the Animal Welfare Board of India. Chinni, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
This is a very different Corridors of Power. Now, you've been an animal activist for decades on end. Of late in Chennai, we've been witnessing this rather sad spectacle. Four incidents in 2 months, close to 100 dogs being killed by allegedly by top companies, by educational institutions. To what would you attribute this spurt in cruelty in a city which, Chinni, is known for its pet adoption drives, you know, with the Blue Cross being so active here, the kind of volunteers that you have? What would you attribute this cruelty to?
You know, frankly, the one that hurt us the most was the one at Vail College, because an educational institution doing something like this was something that we just couldn't understand. They talk about inculcating values in their kids. They are talking about their grandmother and how she gave them the correct values in life.
And but they all deny it. They all say that they haven't done it.
Well, we know they did it. They not only did that, a couple of months before that, they had a program by which they had a cockfight in the school. And Mr. Abdul Ghani was contacted by me because I had been the chief guest at their program about 6 months earlier. And he confirmed that it was done. The chairman called me up and said it was done without their notice. The teacher was suspended. But the fact remains that they staged a cockfight, which is specifically illegal under the Act. And this was to entertain the children on Animal Day.
So four incidents in 2 months, and this is not something that Chennai has seen before. This is a new disturbing trend.
Well, you know, I don't know how much of it is due to increased awareness that we were informed about it. We don't really know how much of it goes on without anybody's knowledge. But it is a disturbing trend, and we are very fortunate that when I met the DGP yesterday, he called up the commissioner and gave instructions that the gang who are going around, they are based in Cheyur village and poisoning the dogs, that they should be immediately brought to book.
There is a gang doing this?
There's a gang of 12 people, I believe.
They've hired goons to even kill dogs, don't
they? Yes. It's very common in Kerala.
Well, we are told that there are about 600 dogs that have been killed in a similar fashion over the last couple of months. And we are told that they are paid. This is what one source told me. They paid about 100 rupees per dog.
Exactly.
This is true.
That's true.
Okay. And in this case, one of the builders whose name figures in the latest first information report and the FIR has said that he's going to sponsor the vaccination of dogs in the vicinity of his township.
He met me yesterday, and he sounded genuinely contrite about the whole thing. He also mentioned that he was greatly disappointed that he has not been able to transmit his values to the rest of his organization. But we are touched that he said he would do it, and we hope
it's
that
like
he follows through.
It's like a CSR initiative.
Well, you know, yes, you are absolutely right. It is a CSR initiative. Many people think that what we are doing here is charity, but this is not charity. For the last 50 years, we have always been looking at this as part of our social responsibility. As I keep repeating, Jack London in one of his books says, charity is not giving food to a hungry dog. sharing your food with a hungry dog when you're equally hungry. That alone is charity. Mm. And by that standard, none of us do charity. Mm. The problem is most of us abdicate our social responsibilities too.
Now, this center here, how many animals have you sheltered? Animals, and I'm told birds as well.
Well, we have about 1,200 at any time.
1,200?
In this one center.
Okay.
We have four centers altogether. So, the numbers are much higher. Mm. But we... If you count the numbers that have passed through here since we inaugurated this in 1997, it probably would run into 20,000 a year or so.
So this land was gifted to you by the
government? This was actually given to us by the Honorable Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Ms. Jayalalitha, when she telephoned us one day and asked us what we wanted on the 30th birthday of the Blue Cross.
Oh, that's a nice gesture, okay.
Oh, it's an amazing gesture.
No, she's and a dog lover herself. We are told that she's very compassionate when it comes to animals. And
it's all animals. Because even the horse racing, she was able to... Horse rides on the marina, she took action. She's been very, very proactive as far as animals are concerned. Mm-hmm. And it was an amazing gift that she gave us. In addition to this, she gave us 25 lakhs in a fixed deposit, which we had to return to the government after 3 years, but we do get a small grant from the
government. That's a good sign that you have a chief minister who is in fact an animal lover herself. Mm-hmm. But talking of cruelty, you have the Animal Welfare Act, which is yet to see the light of day. The Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act is a dead letter virtually. There's no teeth at all in the act, because we are told that you have fines from what, 10 rupees to 50 rupees. Where is the deterrence at?
Ultimately, it's only education that can change people. The fines are there only as a last resort.
But if there's imprisonment, because I saw the draft of the act. In fact, it talks about, imposing a fine of, 50,000 to 1 lakh rupees, also 2 years, 2 year jail term. So there is that, element of criminality there, and therefore it needs the deterrence.
It does, of course it does. But, we would rather that we don't have to use it and that people change on their own. The problem is that there is nobody who's interested in enforcing
these. These are the birds that you've rescued. They come back to say thank you.
These are the birds that were brought in here and that have been released over here. They do come back. They come back twice a day. Morning, they make life miserable for those who spend the night over here. Evenings, it's fabulous music that we get for about an hour and a half.
Okay. So coming back to again the act, Chini. Do you think an act of this sort will actually reduce the levels of cruelty to animals? Because people don't really, it's not a priority.
It's not.
Today it's sadly not a priority. While you have volunteers who come here, and you yourself have been doing honorary work for decades, no one really cares when dogs are killed, as they have been in the recent past.
If you've seen the changes over the last 50 years, I was one of the core group who started the Blue Cross in 1959. So it's 50 years plus. The fact remains that the conditions today are so much better than they were in 59. Mm. The awareness levels are tremendous. And I must say that it has all been due to the recent hype that's been given by the media, both print and the visual media, because a lot of people, for example, the new cases that you were mentioning, you'll be surprised at the number of multiple calls we got on each case complaining that this was going on.
But why are they actually killing dogs? Is it the fear of rabies? Is it, the dogs were just, they saw them as a nuisance? In fact, I learned this from you, that you don't call them stray dogs. One doesn't like the term stray dogs, but they're actually community pets, which they most certainly are. Because even in this case, your staff at Blue Cross were telling me that when they went to this place
the whole
in Kanchipuram,
the children were crying,
where is my Tommy, where is my Tiger? So they are, in every respect, community pets.
Yeah.
They're not stray dogs.
No, a stray dog is really one that has run away from home. Mm. During Diwali, it happens when
talking
people...
Talking of that, in fact, my driver, Narayan, was telling me that, when they catch dogs sometimes, and the dog van goes out, they take them and they operate them and they bring them back. They don't actually leave them in the place where they took them from. So, in a sense, the dog is then new to the surroundings, gets into fights with other animals there, virtually there's no one to take care of the dog. You don't leave them back in the place where they pick them up from.
Sadly, that's true. Mm. But we are yet to meet the new commissioner, and I'm sure that Mr. Devidar will rectify this. Mm. Because as per the dog rules, a member of the animal welfare organization who's doing the ABC is supposed to accompany the dogs for the express purpose of locating and identifying where exactly each dog has been picked up from, so that we can return it to that same precise location.
Your ABC program is a huge success, but what were the initial stumbling blocks? I know you can do
apathy,
a thesis on that.
Apathy to start with, then the usual excuse, you know, we have always done it this way. And very sadly, Sanjay, I must tell you one thing. When we went and saw this for the
first
time...
Just to tell our viewers, ABC, for those who don't know, it's actually Animal Birth Control.
Animal Birth Control. We called it the ABC. It was actually called the Trap, Neuter and Return, like it's called all over the world. We called it the ABC program to show everybody that control of the street dog population is as simple as ABC. And it has been a great success in wherever it's been practiced. The very fact that countries like Egypt, Bahrain, Jordan, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia have all been now trying to implement this. Hong Kong for cats. It's obvious that it works.
See, the way they actually catch dogs, the community pets, the van goes, it's a very crude method that's adopted. If you see them, your heart breaks and they take a steel wire and the way they pull the dogs. Why do we need to do it that way?
Well, we have nets that we are giving all over the place. It's like
I don't know how butterfly nets. I don't know how many places these nets are actually used, because if you look, I mean, an average viewer who's seen a dog being caught, it's usually by these crude methods of the steel wire. And
it's the most traumatic part of the whole operation, really. And it's so easy that, you know, once you have it snared in the loop, all that you have to do is hold the loop and pick it up. Everywhere, that's how it's done. But then here, they don't bother to do that.
Again, I remember when now I don't have dogs, I live in an apartment. But of course, that's another point. There are house owners who specifically say, thou shall not have a dog in the apartment. But there are people who have, for instance, a dachshund. He doesn't require much space.
You see, I don't know how far the association would be able to enforce that ruling. Because
only vegetarians also preferred. So that's...
Well, the reason they say vegetarians also prefer, Sanjay, is for a very simple reason. You know that very few people would like to have a sacrifice on that courtyard.
Okay. We'll slide into a short break on Corridors of Power. When we return, we'll also talk about experiments. We'll talk about using animals in circuses. We'll talk about Jallikattu. How can we talk about that? Stay tuned.